We're going to be reading in Matthew chapter 13 today, and we're also going to be reading a passage from John chapter 6. So the passage from Matthew 13, you find on page 690 of your pew Bible. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 9. You can follow along in the Bible or follow along on the screen. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. He who has ears, let him hear. We turn to John chapter 6. We're looking at verses 1 through 13. You can find this on page 754 of your pew Bible. Let's listen to God's word together. Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is, the Sea of Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he had performed on the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover feast was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 8 months' wages would not buy enough bread for each one to have a bite. Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will they go among so many? Jesus said, have the people sit down. There was plenty of grass in that place, and the men sat down, about 5,000 of them. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated, as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted. So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the ways that your word reminds us of who you are and of who we are. And so, God, we pray that in these next few moments that we have to reflect on the scriptures, on these stories of your son Jesus, that you would give us eyes to see you and ears to hear you, that you would give us hearts and minds that are trained on what you have to say to us and on how you would use these words to shape us. It's in the name of your son Jesus that we pray these things. The 13th chapter of Matthew, which is situated right in the middle of Matthew's gospel, which we've been sort of traveling through over the last few months, recounts a number of the parables that Jesus told. And many of you have likely encountered the teaching of Jesus through his parables at some point in your lives. You've likely marveled at the evocative language and the incisive message that these stories communicate. Maybe you've even thought about what it would have been like to sit at the feet of this amazing teacher, to watch as he taught from a boat, to hear these words come out of his mouth and his voice directly landing on your ears and touching your heart and bouncing around in your imagination. Rather than reading these words as we so often do, filtered as they are through the divide of time and place that separates us from the original audience, not to mention the divide that separates us in some sense even from the original speaker. At some point, maybe you've heard a definition of what a parable is, one that goes something like this. A parable is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Now, that's a fine definition as far as definitions go. In fact, if we reflect on this definition through a kind of sacramental understanding, a viewpoint in which we can imagine God bringing the purposes of heaven and the realities of earth together in some mysterious but powerful way, then thinking about the parables in this way is helpful. But I'm afraid that sometimes when we think about parables according to this definition, we can kind of render them abstract. We fixate on this notion of the heavenly meaning, and then we allow the truth of these stories to hover around out there in the ether, divorced from our experience. We might think of the messages of these stories in terms of pithy platitudes, and we might fail to wrestle with how these stories might root down into our lives in the here and now, how these stories might shape our responses to the struggles and the challenges and the opportunities that face us in the midst of daily existence. So over the next 3 weeks or so, we're going to be looking at a handful of these parables that Jesus shared with the crowds. But we're not going to leave these parables in that context. We're going to also look at examples of episodes in Jesus' life and work. Some of the events that unfolded in the course of Jesus' ministry. And look at how these events demonstrate how these parables might not remain simply words spoken or written, but how the truths of these parables might become lived realities for those who sought to understand Jesus more deeply, for those who sought and who seek to follow Jesus more urgently, in ways that go beyond listening and take us into the realm of putting these lessons into practice. So the parable that we're going to look at today is one of the most famous stories that Jesus ever told. It's the first one recorded in Matthew 13. And I think that's fitting because in this parable, Jesus was, in a way, unpacking for his followers some important truths about the way that the kingdom of God unfolds, the framework that the kingdom of God occupies. To borrow an idea from Wendell Berry, Jesus was saying something about the economy of the kingdom of God. Now, that word economy might scare us a little bit because we can't deny that such an idea is a bit politically charged these days. But the word economy, which comes from the Greek term oikos, which means household, has a far wider and far richer range of meanings than our stunted imaginations can really wrap around. When we talk about the economy of the kingdom of God, we can think of it in terms of the ways that God distributes his goodness, the ways that God distributes his grace, his gifts among his household, the world that he's created, the communities that he sustains. And so in Jesus' first parable in Matthew 13, he gives us a glimpse of some of the ways that God works by referring to the everyday agricultural reality of a farmer who goes out to sow his seed. In this parable, this farmer sows or scatters his seed in a variety of places. Because of Jesus' skill of painting pictures with his words, we can kind of get an image of what this might have looked like. An earthy landowner walking the breadth of his property with a basket on his arm or a bag on his hip, tossing kernels of grain as he goes. Jesus also vividly describes the places where the seed lands. These places are diverse, and this maybe illustrates a process of seed scattering that isn't exactly careful. This seed scatterer is enthusiastic. He's generous. Maybe he's even downright exuberant as he tosses these seeds to the winds. I don't read this as carelessness. I read it as something else. I read it that the one sowing the seed had a zealous sort of joy for the work that he was doing. Maybe he was whistling a tune as he traversed his field, as he skirted his hedgerows, basking in the sunlight, feeling the coolness of the breeze, tossing his seed wherever it might land. And this joyful enthusiasm, this excitement, makes sense if we keep in mind what this image of a farmer sowing his seed is supposed to represent. According to Jesus' later explanation, this process of seed sowing is a way of talking about the Word of God, the way that the message of the kingdom goes out into the world, and the way it is received. And so as the story progresses, the seed comes to rest in four places. Some of the seed falls on the path, on hard-packed dirt, trod under by the traffic of the world, maybe by workers going from one place to another on the property, maybe by trespassers cutting through the farmer's fields, maybe by animals on their way to a watering hole. However this path got here, some of the seeds fall on the path. But they don't stay there long before birds swoop down and gobble them up. Jesus will later reveal that this is what happens when someone hears God's word and understands and doesn't understand it. Now, there could be any number of reasons for this lack of understanding. Maybe it's the fact that the person doesn't really have a community to read and listen and learn with. Maybe it's because this person doesn't really take the time to reflect on what they're hearing. Maybe life experiences obscure the meaning for some reason. I think we can all imagine situations where these kinds of things happen. And when they do, Jesus says, the seeds are vulnerable. The evil one, the devil, comes and snatches away what is sown. Then there are the seeds that fall on rocky places. Some of the kernels that the farmer is scattering bounce off of the craggy terrain that surrounds the fields. And some of it, amazingly, finds purchase. It shoots up quickly, but its growth is short-lived. When the sun comes out, it gets scorched, because without deep roots, it can't withstand the withering heat. Jesus says that these are the people who hear the word with enthusiasm and receive it with joy, but they don't follow through. They're kind of like spiritual tourists. The gospel is just one more thing for them to dabble in. And so when trouble or persecution or even boredom come, their enthusiasm fades just as quickly as it arrives. The third bunch of seeds that the farmer scatters lands among weeds, and anybody who has ever planted anything knows what this means. The weeds choke out the seeds so that they can't grow. According to Jesus, the weeds that do all this choking represent the worries of life and the deceitfulness of wealth. Things that can very easily distract us. Things that can discourage us. Things that can divert us from any potential we might otherwise have to bear fruit. And finally, Jesus talks about the fourth parcel of land that the seeds fall upon, what he calls the good soil. The seed that falls here doesn't suffer the same fate that the other seeds suffer. It is able to root down. It's able to drink in the rain and bask in the sunlight and grow. It's able to produce a crop that is 160 or 30 times what was sown. According to Jesus, this is the heart, the mind, the life that receives God's word, makes a home for it, and experiences growth. Not just growth, but abundance. A harvest that far outstrips what we might be inclined to imagine. This is the soil that participates most fully in God's economy, the workings of God's kingdom. And so this is the soil that I want to spend a little bit of time reflecting on today. In his book, Slow Church, Chris Smith talks about two competing ways of looking at the world. And these are also two competing ways of looking at how God works in the world. We can view this world and God's work and our work in the world through lenses of scarcity. We can look at these things with the sneaking suspicion that we won't ever have enough to do what we need to do or to achieve what we need to achieve. We won't ever have enough to thrive in the ways that we want to thrive. The world that we live in, the cultural context that we are shaped in, is to a great extent formed by this sort of perspective. We look at our own lives, we look at the lives of those closest to us, and we're inclined to focus on what is lacking. We're inclined to focus on what is missing. We focus on what we don't have, on the shortcomings and weaknesses and obstacles that will prevent us from becoming who we're created to be. And when we do this, we despair. We worry. We compete with one another, and we fight with one another, and we seek to exclude one another from a place at the table because we fear that by giving way to those around us, we will lose out on our piece of the pie. We fear that what we have coming to us will go to someone else. It's not hard to see where such despair and such impulses can lead. Turn on the news any night of the week. You can see the results of this perspective. Wars and crime, modern slavery, things like human trafficking, injustice of all kinds can spin out of this toxic understanding of the world. On the other hand, you could choose to embrace a perspective that's shaped by abundance, a perspective that is formed in the scriptural tradition that points to a God who provides for the birds of the air and the lilies of the field and the men and women and children who are created in his image. Now, we have to be careful here. We have to be careful not to confuse a message of God's abundant kingdom, which is at the heart of the gospel, with a message of prosperity. The This message of prosperity has become more and more popular in recent generations. It continues to draw adherents from various walks of life. Many of you may have heard of or encountered the so-called prosperity gospel. It's the stock in trade of ministers who drive Rolls Royces and raise funds for private jets. And this prosperity gospel tells people that if we have enough faith, God will give us the life we've always wanted, full of the goodies that we've always desired, the kind of health and wealth that salesmen have promised potential customers for thousands of years. But even a perfunctory skimming of the New Testament, not to mention a glance at the difficult plight of so many Christians around the world and throughout history, will make it clear that God has not promised us that sort of life. No matter how much we pray, no matter how much we believe, no matter how much we give, in this world we will have trouble. Neither Jesus, nor Paul, nor any of the other teachers and writers whose words make up our scriptures ever promised us any different. And so when we talk about abundance in reference to this parable or to any of Jesus' teachings, not to mention any of the teachings throughout scripture, we're not saying that God will give us the life we've always wanted. We're saying that God will use our lives. God will use the things we offer up to Him in ways that will enrich and bless the world around us, and in ways that will glorify His name. It's a fulfillment of what God promised Abraham when He said, "All nations will be blessed through you." Now, I'll be the first to say that in so many ways, this is a good life. It's a far better life than the alternative. But when Jesus said, "I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly," it was meant to be taken as a positive. It was meant to be taken as a good thing that Jesus was holding out to us. But it doesn't necessarily mean that it's an easier life than a bunch of the other options that are out there. Instead, when Jesus talks about the abundant life, when Jesus talks about producing an abundant harvest, He's talking about the joy and the fulfillment and the wonder that comes from seeing what God can do in us and through us. And the ways that this joy and wonder and fulfillment sustain us, even during the most difficult times. The knowledge that God's word, which we have a hand in not only hearing and receiving, but also in spreading and sharing, this can produce an abundant harvest of goodness and grace. This is a pretty compelling truth. This knowledge can give shape to our lives together as God's people. As I said, it's sometimes difficult to take these parables from the page into the world in which we live and to see what applying these truths might look like. Well, thankfully, the Gospels give us a powerful story, a concrete illustration with a simple action at its center. And this story, even though it's of an experience that is very different from a lot of the ones we'll face, it can still guide us. And this is a story that is found in all four Gospels, but we're going to look today at the version from John's Gospel, the second passage that we read today. It's the story of the feeding of the 5,000. Like the parable that we read a few moments ago, this is a story that many of us have heard before. But it's also a story that demands another look. It's a story of need, and of lack, and of scarcity. It's a story of an almost overwhelming crowd of people we don't have anything to eat. But that's only half the story. This is also a story of God's provision. It's a story of abundance. It's a story of how God can take an act of faithfulness and use it to produce a harvest. Because at the center of this story, once we look past the crowds and even past the disciples, we'll find two figures, Jesus and a young boy. According to John's Gospel, Andrew, one of the 12, brings this boy to stand before the teacher whom the crowds have thronged to see. And the boy presents to Jesus the contents of his basket. 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish. It's not enough, clearly. It's not just that it isn't enough from the perspective of a pessimist, someone who looks at the world and only sees scarcity. It's not enough from the perspective of a rational realist, who looks at the world and sees things as they, quote, really are. But as we know, when the boy offers these things to Jesus, they become enough. Enough to feed a massive crowd. Enough to collect 12 baskets of leftovers. Enough to demonstrate the power of God. Enough to show what can be accomplished when we allow God to use what we have to bless others. This is the principle of abundance in action. When we see limitation, God sees potential. Where we see a lack, God sees provision. And so the question that this parable and the question that this story of a miracle present to us today is the simple question of what's in our basket? The farmer went out with a basket full of seeds to scatter. He experienced some success and some failure, but God produced a harvest. The boy brought to Jesus a basket with his lunch in it. It clearly did not seem to be enough, but Jesus used it to feed an enormous crowd. We come into this place today. We move through each day. We are carrying a basket as well. A basket with our hopes, maybe with our anxieties, our dreams, our gifts, our talents, our resources. These things might not look like much to us. These things might not look like much to those around us. These things might seem laughably inadequate when examined by a culture that can be so cruel to those who don't seem to measure up. But when these things are offered to God, when our lives are offered to God in sincere faith, He will use them. When we hand these things over to the God who created us, the God who gave us life, the God to whom all these things that we carry in our baskets belong in the first place, we will be amazed at how God can take what we have to give and how He can use these things to touch lives, how He can take what we have to give and how He can use these things to change the world. We'll be amazed at how God can take what we have to give and how He can use it to produce a harvest 30, 60, even 100 times larger than we ever imagined. He's perfect. God, I thank You for the life that You have given us, the life You have called us to, a life of abundance. God, I look out at those seated in this room, and it's amazing and it's humbling to see just the enormity of gifts and talents and resources and dreams and vision that is here. God, we know that when we look at our own lives, and especially when we're influenced by the perspective of scarcity, by the perspective of seeing things and only seeing a lack, we might look at our own lives and think that we don't have much to offer. We might look at our congregation and think we don't have much to offer. We might look at our town, our community, and think we don't have much to offer. But we know, God, that You can take what might not look like much, and You can make it far more than we could ever imagine. And so, God, we offer our lives to You this morning. Lord, as we maybe go to work this week, as we interact with our neighbors this week, we may not think we have much to offer the people You bring into our lives, but we have a hope, we have a message, we have the truth of Your gospel, the truth of a God who loves us. And so, God, we pray that we would take those things and we would offer them. We would offer them up to You. We would allow You to use them to change the lives of those around us. Help us to be faithful in this, Lord, as the farmer was faithful in scattering his seed, as the little boy was faithful in bringing his lunch to Your son, and as countless saints, as countless men and women throughout the past several thousand years have been faithful in trusting You and allowing You to make amazing things out of their lives. Help us to offer